You should be warned, the upcoming episode will be full of unfiltered, off-the-cuff discussion. As such, you should consider this your spoiler warning.
Hello, my name is Kyle.
My name is Ryan.
And when our powers combine, we form
Experience Grind Podcast.
We're not the only podcast with two white dudes talking about bullshit that doesn't matter, but hey... We're not the worst. Bam! Two times in a fucking row. I've got it. We're rolling.
Very proud.
So, you know, hey, everybody. This is a special episode. Are we going to, is this going to be a side quest? I don't even know.
I would imagine this would
be a side quest. Yeah. All right.
A side quest?
A side quest are main episodes that aren't topic related to a movie or video game.
But side quests usually are like 3 hour episodes, right?
No.
They can be.
They have. I think we are at three. We've had close to two once.
Yeah.
Ooh, daddy.
That voice you're hearing is the voice of our special guest who drove all the way back from Chicago to be on here again. It's not recorded immediately after the last episode.
Never.
This is my good friend, Alex.
Nathan. Oh, Alex.
Oh!
No, oh, I got it wrong.
I wish it was Nathan. Oh, no, I'm fucking kidding.
Everybody wishes it was Nathan.
That means we're going to be able to hear him.
No, it's my good friend, Alex. Alex, who I've been interested to have on the show for a while because I don't think I've ever known anybody else who... At the point in their life, gave up everything to chase their dream. And Alex did that. He moved to Chicago to become a stand-up comedian. So I want to talk more about this.
That's beautiful.
At the time. That's what you did. Am I wrong?
No.
Oh, so glad we chose to do this second.
Yeah.
Oh, no, God.
See, this is why I'm behind the scenes sort of showrunner. Because I knew this would be the way to go.
Holy shit.
So, Alex. Hey, buddy.
Hey. Thanks for having me on again.
Yeah, man. Thanks for making that fucking drive from Chicago. That's a hell of a bitch.
There are a few things worth it.
Oh, but we are? No, we're
Experience
not.
Grind pod- words. Experience Grind Podcast and Andre Champagne.
Now try to say sound engineer Andre and not say Andre.
He said that so many times in the drunk episode. He called you Angie and everything. I was cracking up
every single time re-listening to it. Anytime Andre dropped.
Andrew isn't hard for me to say because that's my little brother's name. Ah. So sound engineer, Andrew. We know.
Oh, no, Andy's not hard to say because it's a fucking name.
Yeah,
as opposed to Andy.
I try to say Andy, and then we're semi-unofficially sponsored by Andre Champagne. I think it just gets mush mouthed up.
Andre drinks by
it's
Andy.
It's great.
So
I've never had it before
Andre
today.
Andy,
it's
Andre
fucking
Andy,
delicious.
Andre
you do
Andy.
You have enjoyed the Andre. It's not bad, especially for the price point, man.
It's like, good.
It's on sale at Kroger, just to say.
Yeah, extra dry. That's where it's at.
It's all, there was a mango peach infused earlier, and I was just like, I don't know if I'm going
to
get
this
bullshit.
I think we have tried every flavor of Andre, and we keep coming back to extra dry.
Yep.
So
I think the brute's okay, too.
Brute's is okay. Brute's okay. Yeah. But, hey, man, we're going to talk about Alex and his life choices and why they're the worst.
Yeah, I'm not familiar with that champagne. Alex.
Alex's worst life choices. It's a bitter champagne.
Yeah, it's not very tasty. It usually leaves you in the morning unsatisfied.
So, but you know, in the ramp up to this, you had mentioned you feel you know the moment that you and I bonded. You and I worked together for like I would say a month precisely before I quit. You stayed a bit longer
after I quit. I did,
and
stay.
I just couldn't take it. But
I get that.
You and I, we met at training. We started this new job at the exact same time, and we really sort of seemed to have a connection from that point. And you know, we've really stayed in pretty good contact since then, which is crazy for only working together for a month.
Yeah.
So I'd just like to hear this. What you think is the key defining factor?
Well, I mean, we talked through training the whole time. Like we were friends through training. We'd always do coffee runs, but I think the moment that really solidified our friendship was the moment that a young lady in our class was a little worried about her piss test.
Okay, good. This is what you're going to talk
about.
And
she was worried that she was not going to pass it, and she was going to actually be terminated because she smoked a lot of weed.
As did I at this time.
She smoked so much weed. Holy shit.
I actually got this job because of my ability to pass a drug screen and my James Bond / MacGyver-esque riggings of things to do it. Mm-hmm. And what makes it funny, I know what you're saying now. Because I have totally had your piss on my hands.
Yeah. Yeah, you have.
Absolutely.
Well, so I at the time did not smoke weed. I do now. I prefer.
Which is weird because I don't now.
Yeah.
Not by choice.
It's okay. Well, I mean, I'm trying to be creative. You're trying to be all businessy and shit. Yeah, it's
fucking life, man.
So I piss in a water bottle for this young lady.
At the bathroom at work.
At work.
Fucking kudos to you for at pulling work. That off yeah. and sneaking that out, by the way.
Pulling it out, not pulling it off. You know what I'm saying? That's a little dick joke for you.
A little dick joke.
Very little dick joke. So, yeah, it's good that we used a bottle because I could put my whole ball sack and penis inside the bottle. So if that gives you any wow. how a little of a dick joke it is.
Yeah.
So I bring it out to the car where we need to transfer this into a condom and then tie it to the young lady's leg. Well, I feel like when we bonded was when she was at the drug taking place. Which I don't think that's what they're called.
I love drug taking places.
Drug testing. I think you mean drug testing place.
And the condom exploded.
Oh, God.
Also known as splode it.
Yeah.
On her. And
I could not have set it up better. Here was her main issue, because she'd asked me about this many times.
She obviously never used a condom before. It's not, don't be mad at me about it.
It's not my fault.
I've passed many, many, many pre-work drug screenings with other people's pee and condoms. The number one trick you have to fucking do is the night before, you open it and you wash the lubrication off of it. This fucking girl, even though I told her to do this, did not do that. She just brought in a fresh fucking condom. And I'm like, how the fuck am I going to do anything with this? It's slippery all over my hands. It's got fucking lube on it.
Did you enjoy it, though?
No, it was awful because I'm fucking holding this slippery condom, trying to fill it up with your body warm temperature piss in a fucking car in a parking lot on my lunch break when I should be eating, doing this chick a fucking favor, and it all just goes to shit. I get your piss all over my hands, and somehow she still doesn't pass the test. I don't...
It comes back, altered or like inconclusive
so
or something.
She had to retake it at some point. I didn't help her.
We were out. We were like, not doing it again.
We were totally gone.
Nope.
Done.
I'll pee on anything else, but not in a fucking bottle again.
To me, I think.
That's what I said.
Do
you remember me saying that to her? I yelled it in her face.
Yeah.
I was like, I'll piss on anything you want, but I'm not peeing another bottle.
Yeah. I did this for you once.
I did it for you once.
It's a weird line to draw.
I was mad.
It was funny because. I think my bonding moment with you was the night that you got me hooked up with my one and only open mic night that I did stand-up comedy.
Oh, I'm so mad I missed this.
Andy was there. It wasn't bad. I thought my story was pretty good, to be honest. I thought I did all right.
He said, I gave a thumbs up.
He hates stand-up, and he came to support me before this ever even existed. And it's something, now that, you know, not a lot of people know, but I've actually retired from music at this point. So I actually do plan to start doing some more open mics.
Very nice.
So
good for you.
Oh. But that aside, that night.
Let's see how that pays off.
Huh? Yeah.
Definitely move to Chicago. You have a little more opportunity.
There you go.
We'll see how that goes. I want to go.
We'll talk. Indy. We'll talk. Yeah. I want to have this wrap. We're going to break this down.
But, you know, I remember at that time you hooked me up with the guy who did open mics here. And I did it. And it was a fun time. And then you and I just got really fucking drunk afterwards. And we walked around downtown Bloomington and talked to people and yelled at people. And then I had to go to work the next day, and it was awful.
Yeah.
I just remember. But that job was awful anyways. So
I do not miss that job. I miss the people. All. The people were fantastic.
I miss like three people from there, and I'm talking to one of them right now. So I don't even
But we stay in contact. Yeah. It doesn't really matter.
Yeah. It's fine.
Like, I mean. No, I mean, that place, I had the best bosses I've ever had. Not that they'll probably not listen to the experience grind, but Buddy and Rich.
Yeah.
Fantastic
Buddy Rich
bosses.
Was a fantastic jazz drummer, by the way.
No, that's their separate names.
I
thought they were great bosses. Were you there when there was a guy there, his name was Fred something?
No, I don't remember. I don't remember.
Well, I got stories to tell you about.
You and two other people. So.
That fucking guy.
How long did you stay? I literally lasted 1 month to the day. How long did you stay?
I left in May.
It was winter when we started. So
yeah,
it was like,
I left.
I say December because I think I left in November, I want to say, because I still came back for the Christmas
party. Do you guys all know each other from like going across like into different countries and doing shit?
Well, me and Andrew went to high school together, and then he was my boss at my job before I went to there for a while, and it was good times. Not that we did drugs or alcohol together.
I didn't even reference that.
No.
At all. I mean, if you feel like you need to say something.
Completely unrelated.
That's cool, but.
We never did that. But, yeah. So, you stayed till May?
I think I left in May.
And so,
in May of 2015.
Check this out. This is called what we call a transition. So, you left that job to move to Chicago.
I did.
And you moved to Chicago to pursue a career in comedy.
In performance arts.
And acting.
Yes.
Or performance. So there we go. So that's my ham-fisted segue to what we're going to talk to you about today, Alex. And that is, I guess in a air quotes way, chasing the dream.
Hashtag chasing the dream.
I love it.
Follow me on Instagram, Alex Brownstown, hashtag chasing the dream.
All right, here, dickhole. We're going to give you a chance to plug yourself at the end.
I just said all of them. I got in there and I got that Alex Brownstown on lockdown.
So
you hear me, Andrew?
Lockdown in the Browns team.
I've got tons of questions written down. Ryan has none written down. So I want Ryan to start with
God
a question.
Damn it. Why the fuck would you do that?
Ryan doesn't like talking to me.
I love to put you on point, and that's my favorite thing.
The worst thing is I never perform. Just like any
never
other
performs.
Night.
Performs.
Don't perform.
That low-hanging fruit. Don't you put that in my face. You tease.
What you got? All right, you want me to start, and then you can think.
No, I mean, fuck it. Whatever. Like, all right, so you're a comedian. Ha.
Exactly how my mom said that when she found out I was doing comedy. She goes, oh, you're a comedian. Ha. It's like, thanks, mom.
Oh, my God.
All right.
Talk to you at Thanksgiving.
I guess. I don't know what you have, so I might be stepping on your toes with the questions.
Fine. I've got a lot here, so
but
it's fine.
What made you decide you want to be a stand-up comedian? Because I think Kyle and I both really enjoy comedy. But me personally, I would never fucking do it. I don't have that leap to go there. What was your impetus for the leap?
Crippling depression, I would say, would probably be the closest.
That's funny because my last question for you
is that
are
funny?
You depressed?
Is crippling depression funny?
Because a lot of comedians are sad sacks of shit.
That's
true. Louis Marin, they have shows where they just
you really have to love being in front of people. You really have to love it,
which I myself do.
Yeah, you have to. You have to be on the speech team. You have to be a part of debate. You have to be a part of. I was a cheerleader. I was a 4-year cheerleader in high school.
Like a male cheerleader.
Huh. Yeah, I wasn't a female cheerleader.
Yeah,
I was a male cheerleader.
Sounds like a dumb distinction.
We call ourselves stuntmen. It was exciting.
So wait, for real, all bullshit aside, you were really a cheerleader in high school?
Yeah, my freshman year, we won state.
God damn.
Yeah, I have a state championship.
All right. So how much fun of did you get made?
A lot.
Of course.
A lot. But I mean, my question was like, it's either wrestling, where like I'm on a mat where I'm going to get ringworms and I'm wrestling with sweaty dudes, or like I lay on this really comfortable mat with their girlfriends.
And
they're half dressed.
Their butt when you push them up.
I'm not saying that's good.
No, it's fine. I'm repressing the urge because there's a strong urge in me to bring up something about grabbing by the pussy, but I am shoving it down.
We're moving on right now.
I am shoving it down.
Hillary Clinton made that quote, if
first
I remember
question,
correctly.
First question. We're moving on. I'm not getting
so,
first
so,
question.
So how many cheerleaders did you grab by the pussy?
Or
none.
Or buttocks.
That, just to say, I
push
that would have
by
been
by the buttocks. That's the move.
By the buttocks, yes.
Yeah.
But by the pussy is a very unstable, horrible lift. A lot of people could have got hurt.
Yeah.
Exactly like that.
How do you
Andrew just pantomimed it perfectly.
As a fan of the butt, I'd much rather grab the butt than the puss. That's just me.
It was fun. It was fun. It was an outlet to like do stuff.
So this was in high school. What high school did you go to?
Martinsville.
Wow. And you were a male cheerleader at Martinsville.
Oh,
so
yeah.
Do they have to order
explain
a
what Martinsville is for people who do not know.
Martinsville is one of the
explain
most
it correctly.
Because I don't know Martinsville,
from
so it means
there.
Nothing to me.
Martinsville, as I've always known, is one of the most backwoodsy places in Indiana. And it's not a very friendly place to people of different skin colors different sexual orientations.
My first girlfriend was black, and one of my best friends in high school was black.
Okay.
Like, here's the thing. You go to the fucking bum fuck middle of nowhere woods of anywhere, you're going to find asshole racists.
Oh, yeah, absolutely.
You're going to find them in Bloomington. You're going to find them in Columbus. You're going to find them in Bedford. You're going to find them in Indianapolis. Martinsvilles are just a little louder. And the reason they're louder is because they're just – it's not – it's it was a very nice, comfortable place for me to grow up. I understand there's shitty things that have happened in the past. Here's an interesting fact.
Yeah.
Do you know how many black people have been killed in Martinsville?
Two.
One.
Wow. All right.
Do you know who she was killed by?
No, her dad?
Some white dude driving back to Indianapolis. That's where he lived.
Oh, so it wasn't a hate crime at all.
No, it was a hate crime, and that dude needs to be definitely fucked up the butt.
Oh, yeah. But like, that was misleading. I definitely thought it was like a...
It wasn't like she was walking down the street and we did a big lynching. It was like he was driving home and he was like, that doesn't belong. I'm going to go fucking be an asshole. It's shitty because that gets put on my hometown, which I love Martinsville.
Excellent, man.
I love my hometown.
I'm glad of hometown pride.
And there and
so bringing it back, like as a male cheerleader.
Really away from that.
Did they have to order a custom outfit for you? Were you the first male cheerleader at this high school?
I was the first 4-year varsity male cheerleader.
Holy shit.
But
we
did have a lot of men. Yeah. Oh, yeah. Fuck yeah. I lettered in that shit.
Amazing.
Yeah, it was awesome.
I lettered in marching band, but that's not as crazy as a male cheerleader.
Very difficult.
Cheers to you, brother.
I will not make fun of marching
band. Yeah, I'll cheers.
So, all right, man. I got some questions here I want to get into.
Did I answer your question?
I don't know. I think so. There is talk of pussies and lynchings and whatever.
I feel bad about that.
That's the way this show goes, man.
Tangents
happen and then...
Again, sound engineer Andy, feel free to cut out whatever you need to.
Sound engineer Andrea, I have found, has done little to no
cutting.
Cuts.
He does no fucking cutting.
At this
cutting.
Point in the career.
I'm just going to be honest.
He's just in it for the beer and that's fine. Hey, brother. There we go.
I just feel like Ryan's getting more and more uncomfortable. Are you okay, Ryan?
I always have to watch myself once I start drinking because I am the one that takes it too far. Almost always, which you don't hear because it gets cut out.
Hey, Ryan, hey. I just want you to know this is a safe space.
It is, okay.
Oh,
okay.
God.
When is this I was safe? Five, Are we
my
safe?
My uncle touched me.
Whoa, gay! God damn.
Did you say gay? Did you just yell gay?
No, I said
Did you yell gay? All right, hey, I'm going to put some fucking restraint on this. I got a question.
Uncle touched me. Gay!
He was Alex. Not you. You were a child. You didn't know better.
Alex, my friend from Chicago.
Yes.
Outside of comedy, do you currently have other employment?
Why is this question?
Because it leads to other places.
I work in a cigar shop.
So I've seen you post about the cigar shop. So you actually work there.
It's a great job.
So you're a cigar aficionado?
No, at all.
Okay.
But I'm learning.
Okay.
And it's a learning environment, and they're very receptive and helpful when I have things come up that I need to take care of in what I moved to Chicago for. It's a fantastic, little company to work for.
Fucking A, man. I like that. Yeah. And I like that it's out. You're not fucking working at McDonald's.
Yeah.
At a coffee shop.
Which is coming soon. I'll probably be working at a McDonald's.
So, all right. So here's my other segue from that. So the cigar shop, before you did that, you were a dog walker?
I did those together.
You did those at the same time. But you recently left dog walking.
Dog walking probably a couple months ago.
So when you did dog walking, was it like in the rom-com movies where you had like 20 dogs on two leashes?
No, it was individualized, specialized walking with a company called Westtown Walkers. They were rated one of the top 25 dog walking companies in Chicago.
All right, I hope you're getting paid for this.
Fantastic company. No, I still keep in touch with my boss.
Really?
Yeah, with both of them. They're fantastic ladies. Very down to earth. Helped me get on my feet when I moved to Chicago. Like I would not have been there without them.
That was like what you did first, right? That was one of your first things.
I moved to Chicago and worked for a company selling AT&T door to door, and it was 100% commission.
God, that's awful, dude.
I almost got roped into one of those.
Oh, they tricky dicked me.
Yeah.
For those people that know, like presidential elections in the 70s, like they straight got me. And so I got a job with them. She built up my resume. She loaned me money when I had no food.
This is the dog walker lady.
Yeah.
Wow.
Yeah.
Well, all right. Do you want to give a verbal shout out? Maybe just give her one.
Robin with Westtown Walkers, one of the best companies I ever worked for.
Thank you, Robin.
She was awesome.
For taking care of people struggling.
Was awesome. She is awesome. Okay. And we still keep in touch. Like, she's very supportive and wants to know what I'm doing.
So when you did dog walking, did you have to pick up the dog shit?
No, I just left it.
Did you really?
No, God, no. Okay. It's like a $500 fine in Chicago to leave it. Fuck yeah.
Holy shit, I didn't know this.
There's days that, like, you don't want to pick up shit, but, like, you know, I generally would pick it up.
What do you do when it's a watery one?
You just scoop, man.
Really? Yeah. You don't just call it a wash or, like, rub it in with your foot into the ground?
Why would I do that?
Why would I
intentionally step on shit?
I don't know. That's what boots are made for. Not for walking. It's for squishing shit into grass.
These boots are made for squishing shit. And that's just what they do.
One of these days, these boots are going to squish all over you.
That's right. That's right. So, I mean, that's fucking cool, man. I like that you got there and you got established with... And it's weird. Like, I don't know anybody that's been a professional dog walker. So, like,
yeah,
I guess people trusted you with, like, keys to their house to get their dogs and shit, too, right?
Mm-hmm. Yeah, it's fucking crazy.
So, was there, like, any cool places you got to check out?
Oh, yeah. Like, my clients were amazing. It was leaving dog walking was the most difficult decision I had ever made in my life when moving to Chicago. It was the first job that I did not want to leave.
Did you ever jerk off in their houses?
No, I never jerked off in their house.
I totally would have jerked off in those houses, man.
I don't know how I would have felt about that, but no, the pet parents,
fair enough. Okay.
Like they were awesome. They Christmas presents. They would leave me treats. Yeah, they were fucking awesome people. Are you fucking kidding me? You're spending so much time with their animals. I mean, five times a week you're taking them out and you're seeing them and you're shooting them a text and saying, "Hey, hope you're having a great day. This is what you know." Murray, for instance, did today.
I know. I remember Murray. You talked about Murray quite a lot on your Facebook.
He's a doll baby,
and he was a bulldog.
No, he's a golden doodle.
He was a golden doodle. Okay, no. Okay. But you had a French bulldog, right? Or
I had a bulldog, and the lady actually decided to leave Westtown Walkers because she didn't appreciate me posting so many pictures of her dog. On my Instagram.
Controversy.
And I was like, are you fucking kidding me? I was livid. I was like, wow. You would have had to do, and I think she was just trying to find something.
To leave a reason?
Just trying.
Okay.
And because, like, she never had an issue with me taking a picture of her dog. I like Charlie. That was Charlie. He's a little bit.
I remember Charlie too. So, okay.
Oh, yeah.
And I'm sure if she would have said, like, can you stop? You would have stopped.
Of course. Of course I would have. Like
that's
so. It is.
There's one thing I know about Alex. He respects boundaries.
Some boundaries.
Some.
Yeah.
All right. So yeah. I want let's move this conversation, I guess, more towards what you do now.
How I got how I got there and what I did. Like, because I don't think we hit on like me leaving.
Yeah. Let's focus on that. What was the big caveat to you leaving? Like. You left Bloomington, Indiana, moved to Chicago, 4 hours away.
I was 29.
Uh-huh.
I was single. I had no kids. And I was renting...
It's nice not having kids.
A three-bedroom... Do you have kids?
No, none of us have kids.
Not having kids is
a
wonderful.
A three-bedroom apartment on the east side of Chicago, or Bloomington. And I was just like, can't do it anymore. I can't do this anymore. A friend of mine, he had recommended and cheered me on and had been like, you got to go, move to Chicago. What's the worst that happens? You come back. What's the worst that happens? And that's what ended up happening. And I was just like, I can't do it anymore. Mm-hmm. My dad had just got remarried. Like, I legitimately had nothing holding me back. So I saved up $600 and bounced. Went to Chi-Town.
Got the fuck out, man.
Got the fuck out. And it was terrible in the first, like, 3 months.
That's what I want to, like, it was, so it was awful. Like, you didn't know anybody, right?
I had some friends. In my Chicago? Roommates now, they let me crash on their couch for the first month and, like, get my shit together. And, like, I did not plan it well at all. Like, $600 is nothing in Chicago.
No, especially not to move the fuck out on. I would expect a couple of grand at least.
And that's the thing is, like, they said, hey, we think you fucked up, you know, but we're still going to help you and, like, see if we can do whatever we need to do. You know, now a year and a half later, you know, I'm still there. I know more people.
But you pay rent.
Yeah, I pay rent now.
There you go. That's the big change. That's all they care about.
I wish I didn't have to. Like, that would be awesome. Like,
yeah. But, yeah. So how many roommates do you have?
I have three right now.
Three? Do you have your own room, though?
Oh, yeah.
Okay. Okay. So you can masturbate in peace.
Yeah. We live in Uptown, which is not a good neighborhood.
That's nice. Yeah.
I think the funk is going to give it to you when you're Uptown, but that's just me.
If you mean bullets, then yes.
Fair enough. Okay.
But funk, not a lot of funk.
I didn't know that's what Bruno Mars meant.
Yeah. Shit. Yeah. It's a rough little neighborhood. But, I mean... cheap rent.
Yeah.
Chicago, you got to do it.
So, all right. So here's, you left your, when I knew you, you were all about stand-up comedy. Mm-hmm. And you actually influenced me into doing my first and so far only open mic night. But you've still continued to do stand-up comedy in Chicago, I would imagine.
I kind of dabble in and out. It's
not your primary focus. Mm-hmm. But you are... a member of Second City? Is this correct?
I've taken classes at Second City, and I used to intern there.
Okay. So explain to me that. Like, what does that mean? You used to intern? What? Like, so you're not a part of it now, or?
Yeah, yeah.
Because this is all, like, the behind-the-scenes stuff that, as a comedy fan, especially stand-up, I am interested in. Because, you know, Second City has that pedigree. Like, Bill Murray came from there. Tina Fey, John Candy. Like, a lot of...
Well,
big names in comedy.
Think of what Second City used to be and what it is now.
Okay.
So Second City used to be very small, could put out some of the best comedic minds ever. Now it's kind of turned into how many people can we fit through the door? How many people can we have as classes?
So it's about that money.
Less personalized.
It is less personalized, as much as I would hate to say it. Now, that being said, is there still opportunity to move up and meet people and network and grow? Of course. But you're just doing it with about 15,000 other students now, where before it wasn't that way. Mm-hmm. I used to have an internship there. And so the reason I stepped away from stand-up is I had a friend... and this is exclusive. I haven't posted this on Facebook, and I haven't told anybody. I haven't told a lot of people. So I stepped away from stand-up because I was approached by a friend that recommended that I start doing extra work for TV.
Okay, cool.
That being said, I started doing that in October, and I've been on every TV show in Chicago. So every production, granted, it's a background extra. And what started happening was I was showing up late to my internship that would allow me to get a free class. The person that was over the internship asked me, are you here to get an internship with Second City or are you here to act? Which I feel like is the fucking stupidest question I've ever heard. And I told him, I was like, I didn't move here to fucking be an intern.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
And the next day I was relieved of my internship.
Okay.
You know, I feel the thing that's the most important with being creative and being an artist, it's not about how much money you fucking put down on a class. Those things are great and good and glorious and in certain aspects. But if you want to fucking be a podcaster, we live in the internet age where there is everything you want to learn about being a podcaster on the internet. If someone wants you to pay it, that means they're gaining something from it. It's usually a check.
Yep.
That's it. So if you want to learn how to be a good stand-up, you don't learn how to be a good stand-up by watching stand-up helps. But you don't become a good stand-up by going to shows. You become a stand-up by
doing
5 minutes every night, eating shit every single night. You never miss a night. The first 16 months of Jerry Seinfeld's career, he hit 2 open mics a night. He never missed it. He's a multi-billionaire with the nationally syndicated TV show. Biggest stand-up of all time. It's because he ate shit. He was on stage. And in 5 minutes, 5-minute increments. Same thing with acting. If you want to act, it's networking. It's getting to know the gaffers and the sound editors and the lighting technicians and the directors and the PAs, because those PAs in 5 years are going to be the gaffers, and you know,
and so everybody's going to move up.
Exactly. Yeah. And that's the thing that drives me nuts, is people are like, oh, you need to go spend $3,000 on a writing program class through Second City. And it's just like,
why?
Why would you do that when you can have on-set experience?
One of my rules when I was a musician, I there were so many people that were predatory, and they want you to pay to play. Like, oh, hey, man, we've got this semi-big act coming through town. If you pay us like $1,000, you can open for them. And it's, I'm never going to do that. Yeah. If you want me to open, I will open based on my merits and my performance and my talent. I'm not going to pay you to give me the chance. That's fucking bullshit, and it's predatory, and I don't like that. So,
and that's
just industry. Yeah, I totally commend you for that. You have to make it on your own.
Yeah, and no one gives a shit what you're doing.
No.
No one can. The most
Trust
conflated.
Us. We know. The most no one gives a shit what you're doing.
I've ever met.
Were just most extras. Aspects of my life. Yes.
It drives me, and this is, I don't know if it's more glaring in this industry that I'm in, I'm doing now, or if you've noticed this, there are people that you'll meet on a daily basis that think their shit doesn't stink and they're the next fucking big thing. And it's just like, hey, man, like, you're an extra. What are you, like, you get paid the same exact rate that I make today.
Hey, buddy. Welcome to Working with Ryan on a podcast.
Aww.
I'm just fucking around. I love this guy to bits.
Aw, I don't think that's true at all.
He loves you to bits.
That was a bullshit.
To bits.
A dumb joke.
So
you don't do stand up much anymore. Mm-hmm. So your primary focus right now is on acting.
Yes. Yeah. Stand ups are weird.
In what way?
Some would say not good at all.
Stand-ups, and this is an overarching statement, and don't get me wrong, I'm not saying this shitting on any stand-up. It is the most difficult thing I've ever done in my life.
I would agree, and after doing
it
once.
I was not good at it. I was not.
I enjoyed your times that I saw you.
I was not remotely good at it. If I would have had the fortitude and continue to push through, I could have been good. But stand-ups... Being a stand-up is the fucking hardest thing I've ever seen in my life.
Yeah, absolutely. So, I would totally agree with that.
One heckler, and I'd be done. I couldn't do it.
In doing that, stand-ups, they drink a lot. And they're very self-deprecating. And they're very... like I said, when you met me, I
this
was...
This is all me right
when
here.
When you met me, I was extremely depressed. I was 50 pounds overweight. I was mad at the world. I was sad. I wasn't happy with life. And that's why I stepped away from stand-up, because it's a imagine moving to Chicago and going to an open mic and seeing stand-up comics that you have seen come to Bloomington, thank you, and seen come to Indianapolis and hang out, and you are smoking a cigarette and they ignore you like you don't exist.
All right,
it's
so
fucking difficult.
Can I talk to you about that a bit? Because the one night that I did open mic with you, there were, like, I think maybe 10 comedians. Jesus Christ, Andre. I fucking blame you for all this. Nice there job, were 10 Andrew. Comedians on that set. Out of all of them, you were the only one that fucking talked to me after the show. We even went out for drinks at a different venue afterwards. Everybody fucking ignored me.
Yeah.
And it's fucking dick, dude.
It's awful.
Fuck you, assholes.
I know.
You and me, Alex, we're tight.
Boop.
Fuck that shit, though.
I should have done something more masculine. No, I mean, that's the thing.
I'm not the guy I talk about more masculine stuff.
I mean, that's the thing, is that's why I stepped away from stand-up, because it seems like it's fuck you until you make us laugh.
Yeah.
But we're not going to laugh until you keep showing up and you've been here for 2 or 3 years.
Yeah.
And that's shitty,
like a,
especially
like an initiation,
in Bloomington.
Like a hazing almost.
It's super hazing. But in Bloomington? Like, who the fuck are you? You're in Bloomington. And you want to tell me something? You could be the fucking hottest shit in Bloomington, Indiana. But I moved before you. What the fuck are you still doing here? Why are you still here?
Talk about big fish in a tiny pond.
Oh, that's a tie back to the earlier episode you were on. You remember that one years ago?
Big fish? It was years ago. But that's why we're...
If you've not listened to or watched it, you can also check Alex out on the Big Fish podcast we did.
That's the thing is...
That's a plug, motherfucker.
That's people's mentality, that they are... they're farther than they are.
Yeah.
Just
because
they know these stand-ups and they can get on a mic anytime they want in Chicago or Columbus or Dayton or Kentucky or Louisville. They think that they're here. When if you want to make it, fucking move to Chicago, New York, L.A., wherever. Just move. If you're not moving, you're fucking stagnant. And don't tell me that your art's doing anything if you're doing that. That being said, there are comics that started before me that are still here in Bloomington that are the funniest fucking people I've ever seen.
Yeah.
But my only wish is that they fucking move. That's my only wish for them is that they get out.
Because why exactly is that? You say if they don't move, they're stagnant. Why is that? Why can't they hone and perfect while staying in one place?
Before you answer, can I give my interpretation and you can
clarify?
So I think comedy at its base is about a life experience.
Experiences.
And if you only are in one position, you are only experiencing life one way and you don't get to get a broad generalization that more people can relate to.
But wouldn't you also say that most of, like, name your favorite comedian. Don't they have a specific style or a specific thing that they are kind of known for?
For
and
sure.
not a wide variety
but
of things.
But they've achieved that over years of experiencing things and refining that. Now, Alex, please.
Here's my thing. How many open mics can Bloomington offer a week?
None, as far as I know now. There used to be one.
Comedy Attic has a Wednesday night. When I was here, we had Tuesday night.
But Wednesday night, I know you have to guarantee at least 10 people
before
they
bring
let
show.
You on stage. Yeah, and I hate that shit.
You have to guarantee show. That you will bring 10 people.
And oh,
10 people.
When I'm doing open mic, that's my thing. I'm not good, so I don't want people to see me at the beginning. I just want to do it. And
there are other mics. Indianapolis has mics that you
exactly.
go. It's not a bringer.
And I need to. And again,
but the thing
I
is, in Bloomington, Indiana, there might be two open mics.
Maybe
a week.
At this point. So
in Chicago, there are upwards of five a night.
Okay.
Mm-hmm. So if you're wanting to refine and become better, what's going to make you better?
More practice.
More practice. On stage time. You're going to network better. You're going to learn who people are. You're going to get into the scene and all that kind of stuff.
Okay. That makes complete sense.
That's my thing. New York's the same way. So is L.A. L.A., you're going to have to drive just like you were in Chicago or like you would in Indiana. But that's my thing is why not? That's why I moved to Chicago is I was like, why not surround myself?
Keep going. I have to pee.
Why not surround yourself with open mic after open mic after open mic? But that's the thing. You can't convince other people of the grind and persistence that they're going to have.
Mm-hmm.
Like what you're willing to sacrifice to do what your dream is.
Mm-hmm.
I just found that stand-up isn't the dream that I wanted to pursue.
Interesting. So then what dream did that morph into? What did that dream become?
Just being a performer. I think just being on stage. Stand-up isn't something that scares me like it used to. Neither is improv, sketch, or acting. Like that's what I want to do. I want to become a more well-rounded performer.
Okay. Just performing in general. So that makes sense with the acting. You're talking about being an extra on these TV sets. What about like theater stuff? Like is that an interest for you? Like going the more dramatic route and... That way?
My third audition in Chicago for theater, I was able to become a part of a cast of a one-act improv play. Super fun.
Whoa.
It's like theater is something that I want to do, but my main goal is TV movies. Like that's what I want to do. Like that's what like I dream about. Because it's like it's something first that we've been taught for a very long time, from when we were children. That is not you cannot accomplish it.
It's a hard and unattainable thing to get to.
Extremely unattainable goal. Mm-hmm. You're never going to be able to reach it unless you get a big break. Which big breaks are just 100 tiny, small breaks, you know. Yeah. But that's what you know. I realized that I wanted to do is the first time that I was on set. Was like, I want to do this.
You want to be an actor.
I want to be an actor. But I thought it was easier. When I started doing stand-up, I was like, no way can I be a stand-up. Mm-hmm. And then you meet Louis C.K. When I didn't meet Louis C.K. You meet Patton Oswalt.
Okay.
And you meet Jimmy Pardo. And you meet Emo Phillips. And you meet Beth Stelling and Ryan Singer and comics that you fucking love. And you go, oh, this is a fucking smaller pond than I expected. you meet David Koechner, you know?
Oh, okay. Yeah.
And then you go, okay, well, yeah, I could probably do that. I just, what do I need to do? It's the same thing with acting. Like, it's such a small pond. You just get in, you start flopping around, you get opportunity, you know? And there's steps that you have to take, like getting representation and getting work that way.
So do you have an agent?
I just signed with a company on Friday.
Fucking A, man. Congratulations, yeah.
Thank you,
dude.
Thank you, thank you. I'm very much super excited about it. Yeah, we'll see.
Hell yeah.
We'll see if anything happens for
us. Let's hope it does.
And, yeah, I mean,
from listening to other people talk about it, don't be afraid to fire them if they don't achieve your dreams.
Well, and that's the thing is in the in this industry, there are in my career I'll have 100 agents.
Yeah.
I'll have one manager.
Yeah.
You okay. know, so they're my first agent and they're willing to give me work and
all right.
You know, hopefully we'll see what happens.
Very cool.
So I want to focus back more right now onto comedy and the stand-up aspect. I want to get into hecklers. Okay. Have you ever had any? And how,
oh, of course.
How did you deal with them? Were you more like a deer in headlights? Or
That's the funny thing about stand-up is you think that you're going to like shit all over this fucking person that's talking to you.
It's fucking rough.
And until you're in that situation, you're like, I am not going to be able to overcome this beast. here, the problem that I ran into a lot was I telegraphed my punchline so people knew what my jokes ended. So they'd be like, this is how your joke's going to fucking end. There's not a really good, like comeback to a heckler if they've already said your punchline.
Yeah.
Other than like, yeah, you're right. All right, my name's Alex. Have a good, you know, like there's no... And that happened a couple times.
Okay,
and,
that know, sucks, man.
And she's old and she'll die soon. And that's that's fine.
Oh, like, you heckled by an old lady?
I did.
Whew. Whoa.
An old lady that came to see a clean Christian comic, and they actually were like, we're actually going to do an open mic.
And they fucking heckled?
She heckled me, that drunk wine bitch.
All right.
She's lucky so, I didn't curb stomp her.
That's crazy.
I would have totally fucking ripped that bitch an asshole, told her that me and Satan were best friends. All that shit.
You would have?
Oh, absolutely.
I'm not friends with Satan, though.
Did you see
this punchline coming? I'd jerk off to Passion of the Christ three times a week.
For real, like, I still want to do stand-up, and I'm interested in it.
Do
just
it.
To become, like, a guy that fucks with hecklers.
Hey, the amazing Jonathan, you know how he dealt with hecklers?
I love the amazing Jonathan. I actually, amazing. Here's a bullshit thing. I met him in an airport when me and Andrew were traveling.
Andrew?
I call him Andrew because after many, many drunk mispronunciations, that's what he's
doing. You met the amazing Jonathan?
I shook his hand in the airport, and I was like,
he's not doing well.
Not now. And he wasn't at the airport. He did not seem excited that I recognized him.
He might be dead.
He was...
Like, he's at the end.
Can we get a check on that? On if the amazing Jonathan is dead?
Like, he had, like, a terminal illness, like, a year ago. And he
did. He
might...
But he was really sad when I recognized him. He was like... Oh shit, you recognized me. And I felt really bad at that point. And I was like, all right, I'm going to leave you and go drink for free on Andrew's drink ticket in the Sky Lounge.
Oh shit. This lotions I just popped into my mouth tastes straight like black licorice and shit.
Is it Ricola?
Mm-mm.
What do you got? You got Halls?
It's Halls. Sugar free.
Dog, you always go Ricola.
That's the no sugar free stuff.
You always go Ricola.
Halls, you fucking suck. I'm really mad at you right now. No, but the amazing Jonathan, the reason he became such a good heckler combative was that he worked at a strip club in Alaska, and he would do a set between each dancer.
Damn.
And when you got a word on if he's alive or not? He's still alive. Okay. Bing, 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 bing. 58. Oh,
58.
Wow.
God damn.
So when the hecklers would start, he'd be like, it refined the skill of him telling them to shut up.
Fair enough.
Yeah. And so that's how he started.
I always appreciate, and you know, I will bring back to this. My favorite thing in comedy is when Bill Burr came out, I believe in Philadelphia.
Yeah, it was Philadelphia.
And just fucking decimated that crowd that had eaten four previous comics alive, and he was just like, you know what, fuck you guys,
12 minutes,
yeah, and he just fucking went off for 15 minutes on this crowd, and beautiful by thing. The end they loved him and they adored him, and it is one of the greatest pieces of stand-up I think in history.
Well,
it is
fucking phenomenal what this guy does to this crowd.
I heard a story about Bill Burr that a stand-up comedian saw him at, like, the Laugh Factory or some shit like that. It was like, oh, Bill Burr, you're, like, my biggest inspiration. Like, I want to be just like you. And Bill Burr was like, you're not going to be just like me. Have you heard the story?
No, but that's fucking wise. Keep going. Yeah, I'm shaking my head like that's good advice,
like,
yeah.
He was like, you're not going to be like me. Kid was, like, real disheartened. He was like, when you're out fucking around with your friends and getting drunk, like, I'm at home writing. When you're fucking playing video games, I'm writing. When you're watching a movie, I'm writing. When you're fucking your girlfriend, I'm writing. Like, when you're doing all this shit that you think is awesome, I'm at home becoming the greatest stand-up by writing.
So, spoiler alert for the end of this podcast. In my opinion, Bill Burr is the greatest comedian of all time. But
we'll all time. I say Bill Hicks.
Bill Hicks is great, but I think Bill Hicks died before he achieved his true greatness.
Cancer's a bitch.
Well, and that's the thing. Like,
this podcast
he will go
is
down.
A time loop. Kyle doesn't care about fucking time or order. It's just fucking all in place. Like a fourth dimensional puzzle. Terrible.
That's the way comedy is, baby.
Blah, blah, blee, blah,
true.
Blah.
So here's one
Drew Carey, by the way. Drew Carey is the best comic.
On my list, worst bomb you've ever had in stand-up.
Ooh.
I want to hear about this.
The worst bomb in stand-up.
So for people
I feel bad. I feel like I should have told you I transitioned to acting. I feel like all these questions are stand-up.
I want to talk about this acting.
We'll get to
the worst bomb. I had written a joke about Caitlyn Jenner.
Cool. I want to hear.
And I don't even remember it.
She's a brave person. You can only say she is brave.
She is brave.
She's so brave.
She is so brave.
To be completely honest. Why? Because she voted for Trump?
No.
It's a South Park joke.
It's a South Park joke.
But yes.
We totally rip off everything.
Oh, yeah. I guess she did vote for Trump. Yes, she did. Mr. Garrison.
I had...
Fuck them all to death.
I had a set in Boys Town, which is the gay district in Chicago.
Okay.
All right.
And I decided that was the one to try out my very first Caitlyn Jenner joke, which I don't remember. And I will take a guess and say it was a garbage joke anyway.
Can we
I
hear
don't remember
something
it. I
of
don't
it?
Remember. I swear I swear I do not remember it.
Damn.
But I get up there and I tell the joke and it falls flat. And I apologized. And this is when Tom...
You apologized on mic? You don't do that.
Tom Brady, who is a very funny Bloomington-based comic,
okay,
who's now in
Tom
New York.
Tom Brady, the Patriots quarterback.
Yes. Tom Brady, the Bloomington stand-up.
Okay.
I said, I apologize. I'm not the funniest Bloomington comic that you've heard tonight. And someone in the back goes, yup. I go... I think that's going to be my time, guys. Thank you so much. It was the biggest bomb I've ever had. I cannot remember the joke.
Ugh.
Oh,
well,
I wish you did because
I'm glad that I don't.
Conversely, what is the joke you are most proud of, regardless of how it landed?
That's a great question. Thank you.
What joke are you most proud of? You're like, that's a fucking good one. Like, you had to pat yourself on the back.
Again, this is all joke related. Before you moved into that.
There's a joke that I wrote about... About abductions.
Like child abductions.
Like alien abductions.
Oh, okay, alien
abductions. I'm on board already.
Okay.
I love aliens.
And I'm still trying to work it. I'm still trying. I think it has so much opportunity, but I can't figure it out.
Can you give us the raw? And we'll help you. Yeah. Kyle and
so,
I can help you live on air.
So I find it interesting that these little gray aliens, they fly all over the country, and they abduct from like the most... southern, like backwoods, fucking. They never abduct from like New York or like major cities,
mm-hmm.
which I find interesting because, like, the Grays, for the most part, like the South doesn't like the Grays. They don't like gray marriage. They don't like
gray marriage.
Yeah.
Very nice.
Yeah.
Very
nice. They don't like Grays making their wedding cakes. They don't like Grays on the whole. Yeah. So like. That's
the one that put it over. Gray wedding cake is the one that.
Yeah,
got
that's a joke that like I think is way funnier than it probably is.
Here's the reason, this is just completely not comedy based. I think the reason aliens abduct people is not.
Oh, you're gonna actually answer my question. think that this was a legitimate question
I needed an answer to?
All
right, so you totally ruined it. I was gonna try to make it a joke. I think they do that because. Those people are so used to being anally probed by their relatives that they don't even care.
The gray wedding cake was better.
It was way better. I'm not challenging that.
So going into that is a fishing joke as well.
Oh, okay.
Big fish.
Yeah. Well, I guess my question is is like when we're fishing and we catch a fish and we release it, does that fish like is that did we just turn that fish into the like UFO abduction psycho in his community?
People
like,
don't believe
goddamn Gary. He's just like, I swear, I was eating, and then I was like looking at this fucking big-eyed motherfucker. He's like, oh, I don't think I want to keep, and then throw him back. That's what happened. Yeah, sure, Gary. That's what happened.
Weirdo.
You fucking psychopath.
Very nice.
Like those are the two jokes that I love the most.
Why don't you do stand-up anymore?
Stand-ups, it's weird. I don't know. I might dabble back into it.
You really should.
It depends. Like, when I started doing stand-up, I was like, bah! Very Louis C.K.
Louis C.K. The few times I saw you, and you have actually seen me my only time I've ever done stand-up. And I don't think it was very good, but that's me.
It's all relative.
Yeah, fair enough.
Like, I mean, good... You're doing it. You know how many motherfuckers?
Notice how he didn't say, no, Kyle, like, it was good.
Yeah, he didn't.
No, do you know how many people are like, oh, I wish I could do it, but once I hit that first heckler, I don't know what I'd do.
I can't do it.
Just do it. I mean, just whatever the fuck it is. I don't give a shit what it is.
If you
find your love in fucking calligraphy, do it.
Yeah.
How did you know?
Sure. Like, if you find your love in blowing 10 guys at once, do it.
But also, get paid for it.
Yeah, like don't be.
I think that's prostitution, and I think that crosses the line. Don't do
it. No, it's prostitution if they pay you.
Pornography.
So you're paying for the blowing 10 guys?
No, if they.
Well,
pay
you always
you,
play for blowing 10 guys. Okay, we'd be right.
If they're paying you, but it's on camera, that's pornography, and you're a star. If you're doing it behind the fucking McDonald's, that's prostitution.
I'm just saying. Do you know how many people that we interact with on a daily basis that are just like, ugh?
Yeah.
That hate
like,
their life?
Oh, really? Like, tell me about your life. Ugh. Like, enjoy what the fuck you're doing. Rather, like, find something for the love of Christ. Like, do something that inspires creativity. If it's doing a podcast or watching a movie or fucking listening to old-time jazz on 8-track, do it.
Did they make jazz like, on 8-track?
I don't know. I was hoping you'd leave it. But the thing is there's so many people that they want to bitch about what's going on politically or what's going on with their sports team or what's it's like. We're here for such a finite moment. I'm 31. I might have 50 years left.
Maybe
80, that's generous.
81 is a very, very generous 50 years.
Here, if you'd looked into the glass eye of the witch, you would know exactly where you're going to go.
He'll be driving home tonight. That's probably what's going to happen.
So I guess let's transition from the comedy, the stand-up comedy, to the acting.
Like okay. Caitlyn Jenner.
Yes, exactly. Precisely.
Smooth and beautiful.
Do we want to play some music like Pumped Up's Kids or like Pumped
Music,
Up Kicks?
Excuse me.
No, like, and take a break before we jump into this?
Well, I mean, we can take a break, but here's the thing. If we play music, we don't get... paid YouTube
sponsors. Do we get paid YouTube sponsorship anyway?
So here,
cut the Smash Mouth.
Be like beep pop. Did you cut it really?
No,
we're cutting now to Smash Mouth.
That was Smash Mouth.
That was
Smash Mouth with somebody once told me that the world was going to owe me. No.
No, you didn't have to do Smash Mouth.
We do. I said it. I said Smash Mouth. We're going to Smash Mouth.
All right. So here's my thing.
I've seen you do. You get Smash Mouth for your episode.
I get Smash Mouth.
You get Smash Mouth.
Can I get walking on the sun?
No. You get sea level.
Can I get odds are?
Alex.
Oh, God. You know way more Smash Mouth than I do.
All right, so you said no one ever. You have moved on from comedy to acting. But when you did stand-up comedy, what would you classify your style as? Would you classify it as alt?
Self-deprecation.
It was self-deprecation.
Super self-deprecation.
Which I fucking love.
It's easy.
Yeah.
I mean, everybody loves when someone's like, oh, look how fat I am. They're like, oh, he's fat. Like,
what subject do you know better than yourself? It's the one that you live with on a daily basis. So I totally get that. Did people respond well to it?
Sometimes. It really depended.
Yeah.
Like, I loved stand-up. I loved stand-up as much as I loved acting in the beginning. And I don't know. I miss stand-up. Stand-up's like that girl that you can never get to come. And you're like, you think about her still. Because you're like, I want to go back and see if I can finish that off. You know what I'm saying? Ryan doesn't know what I'm talking about.
I've not had that issue.
No one knows what I'm talking about? God damn. No.
I didn't know girls could come. That was only a dude thing.
No, they come to the kitchen, make you a steak sandwich.
Oh!
Yeah, let's be morning radio DJs.
Okay.
Oh!
If you were a morning radio DJ, what would your radio DJ be?
Alex the Bulldog Brown.
Oh, fucking A, you were on top of that already. Alex the
Bulldog
Brown.
That was my radio radio name in college.
It was? Mm-hmm. Damn.
Because WROL.
So you were a college radio guy.
Yes, at Vincennes University, where all your hopes and dreams go to die.
They do. What hours did you broadcast?
I think 3 to 5 in the afternoon.
Oh, in the afternoon? That's not as bad. If it was going to be AM, I was going to say you were... Nobody fucking cared about you, but 3 to 5 in the a.m. is not a bad time.
Yeah, it was a bad time.
Ryan, what would your radio DJ name be?
I don't know.
No?
Like a Ryan Stone Cowboy. That's the best I got.
Fucking yeah. A! And you would play only the classic country hits.
I hate country. Why did I put myself into this corner?
Because you didn't
get it. I hate myself.
So you would do self-deprecating humor if you did stand-up?
I wouldn't do stand-up because I'm not a storyteller. I can't perform in front of people.
You don't have to be a storyteller. Here's the thing. Alex will tell you, I did storytelling-type comedy. Alex did not.
Well,
he was more joke-oriented.
We'll rewind that back. Ludacris got the clap to make something to make your booty clap. What? Got the beat to make your booty go clap. That's
fair enough. Okay.
Andy having a stroke? He's straight up Albert Finney.
This is literally the most active I've seen Andy the entire show.
Andy's like, having a fucking blast.
All of the experience.
Yeah.
I have no confidence in front of people. Like, public speaking was like my worst nightmare. I would never do stand up.
Some people don't.
Which is amazing.
Some people
are
just fucking not do it.
You do take part in a podcast.
I'll tell you, like, sometimes it wigs me out with like the camera.
Yeah.
But like when we were doing just audio, I had no problem because it's just me and you talking, Kyle. Yeah, like, for no sure. issue. But with the camera, it weirds me out. And sometimes I get like a little stage Friday.
You should do something that scares you.
I think so.
You should get up on stage, do 5 minutes. I have a friend that runs an open mic in Bloomington. I'll put him in contact with you.
All right, I don't know if it's going to happen this time, and next time you come to town, let's do something. Let's get an open mic.
Well, we absolutely, if we do it, we need to record it for the show.
For sure.
That will be like one of our experiences.
I don't know if you know this about me. I like to perform.
Oh, yeah, I know.
I like to be in front of people.
Yeah.
And I feed off of that. But that's me.
I
would like to see you in that environment.
Dude, I am such a shut-in. I can't.
Here, this is what you do when you're starting stand-up. You go on stage and you say, nothing I'm about to say is going to be funny. No one's going to laugh at me. And then you have no expectations. So when they do laugh.
It's great.
Or when they do clap, it catches you off guard.
I told a story about my girlfriend throwing up on my cock. That was my
first. Strong first move.
Wow.
That was my first experience into stand-up comedy. And it went over fairly well. I was surprised.
Nice.
I really enjoyed it. I'm surprised I haven't not got back into it. I think it's because you moved away and you were my real main sort of contact.
Hey man, you gotta drive that. You gotta drive your
exactly.
own boat.
Exactly. But I had other things.
I just did a Larry the Cable Guy thing for some reason. Hey man. Hey man, you got to get her done on yourself. You know what I'm saying?
It doesn't surprise me because you're from Martinsville, Indiana.
Hey, I tell you what.
All right. So
here's a funny story. I actually auditioned for The Exorcist, which is on Fox.
Oh yeah, the TV show. Yeah. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
They were looking for
a giant Westboro weed?
Westboro Baptist type protesters. I auditioned. I thought I nailed it. It paid good money. And then they were like, I'm sorry, you're not redneck enough. I was like, you know where I'm from, bitch?
Do you know where the fuck I'm from? I hate the blacks.
And then, whoa, hey.
That's what you should have said.
Hey, bye, Ryan. It was nice because I didn't realize at the time that they were using me. They were wanting to use me as Vatican security in a future episode. But at the time, I was like, oh, man, I super look racist. What the fuck?
I'm the most racist motherfucker you'll ever meet.
That's
bitch.
What it is. I appreciate it, though. Like,
don't you know?
So what was that question?
I have a few that will...
It's going to be a long episode. I can tell.
It's okay.
I feel like it's going to be like an hour 45.
My first one.
2 hour.
And this is for the both of you. In your opinion, the best comedian working today?
Best is hard. Let's just say favorite.
Okay. That applies too. It's best favorite would be like, your best. And that's a personal opinion. So best can also be favorite. So.
Okay.
I don't know.
Louis C.K.
Louis C.K. And that is a very fantastic.
I think
I enjoy Louis C.K.
I think Louis C.K. Is doing more hard hitting things. He's questioning the norm, and he's saying stuff that's uncomfortable. This is a guy that just a year ago did a child molestation joke on Saturday Night Live
on SNL. Yes.
I mean, I think Louis C.K. I think that you are hard pressed to find someone that is doing it as well as Louis C.K. right now. That's a 25-year plan, though. I mean, he's been doing it forever.
Ryan? Do you have anybody?
Yeah, I'd go with Hannibal Buress.
Very fucking
I love
choice.
Hannibal Buress. And
I
if
love
you're going
Hannibal
like
too.
Relation to, you know, political subjects, like he's the one that outed Cosby because he stuck on that fucking joke for so long and made something happen out of it.
Hannibal Buress is also fantastic on the Eric Andre show.
Yes.
Like Jesus.
It's that dry
very
kind of delivery. Like that's what I like in my stand-up comedian.
What I love about this question is that all three of us for the first time ever have different answers. And I think I've shown my cards earlier. In my opinion, the best comedian working today is Bill Burr.
None of these are bad choices, by
exactly,
the way. They're
yeah.
all good.
Bill Burr he just has a pulse.
Mine's definitely the whitest.
Yes.
You think Louis C.K. is whiter than Bill Burr?
I do.
Yes, I do.
Really? Because I would think Bill Burr is whiter.
As a
but that's me.
He's balder.
I mean, he's got that Boston thing going.
He also is married to a black woman.
Bill Burr?
Yeah, you didn't know this?
Good for him, man.
The lovely Nia. Shout out to Bill Burr. His wife is a woman of color.
Is that a thing?
Yeah. He talks about
model?
It all the time. She was actually on two episodes ago, one of the best episodes of his podcast I've ever heard. But, yeah, for me, it's Bill Burr. Fucking hands down. I love that he's so anti-PC.
Yeah.
And
he'll
anti...
tell you what he thinks.
Yeah, he's fucking
amazing.
Who do
you think the best stand-up of all time is?
That's the one I didn't want to get into, but I'm glad you brought it up. Of all time?
That you didn't want to get into?
Well, because it's
we're
so,
going an hour 50, man.
It's so
cool.
Subjective. All right, so I'll go first here. In my opinion, best comedian of all time, my favorite that I personally love, George Carlin.
Okay.
Hands
Robin
down.
Williams.
Robin Williams, also very good choice.
Richard Pryor.
That's the trifecta right there.
Yeah. Yeah.
George Carlin, Robin Williams.
I'd put Eddie Murphy into that circle because back in the Delirious and Raw days, like perfection, like really good stand up. But yeah. What stand up comedians do you find you relate to the most? Like when they tell their stories,
Jim
like,
Gaffigan.
Oh my God, fucking
Jim
me.
Gaffigan is good. Yeah. Very nice choice.
Yeah,
that is.
Me personally, I would.
As
honestly,
I know you so well, Jim Gaffigan is a great choice for you.
As weird as it is, I like to eat a lot.
He likes his hot pocket.
He's just married and has family. He's happy. That's cool.
I would say maybe Daniel Tosh or Anthony Jeselnik because both of them are
I
so
love Jeselnik.
Like they don't fucking care.
I find Jeselnik extremely boring. Not saying he's a fantastic comedian.
Yeah.
Not saying that he hasn't worked his ass off.
It's that dry.
Here's the beautiful thing.
I actually like Lisa Lampanelli more than I do Jessel Nick.
Lampanelli's the worst, in my opinion, but that's me.
It's all relative, see? I disagree with
that. I also really like, still living, Maria Bamford. God damn, I love Maria Bamford.
Mark Maron.
You know, all right.
Yes.
That's all right. So Maria Bamford, I do not like her stand up, but like I love her when she's in things. Like
really?
Her show Lady Dynamite, fucking love it. Fantastic.
I'm the complete opposite.
But I don't like her stand up.
I went to see Comedians of Comedy when she was on it, and she actually had to take a step away. So, fucking pity me. I got to see two Patton Oswalt sets because he filled in for her and then also closed the show.
Sorry to hear that, man.
Yeah, but no, it was actually great. But that also got me introduced to Brian Posehn, who I fucking love. And here's one of the highlights of my personal stupid, boring fucking life. I got stoned as fuck with Brian Posehn one night after he played at the Comedy Attic.
Surprised not Doug Benson.
Cool.
Benson, he's never come to Bloomington. Comedians of Comedy. Has he been at the Comedy Attic?
Yeah, man. He comes to fucking Comedy Attic every year.
So here's my spoiler.
Getting Doug with high is like one of my favorites.
I'm not a big Doug Benson fan either, but if you want to smoke with a comic, he's the comic to smoke with.
For me, it's Brian Posehn, man.
Yep. Doug Benson's at the Limestone Comedy Festival. If you live in Bloomington, Indiana, and you have not went to Limestone Comedy Festival, first off,
Fuck you.
Okay, so
buy a fucking ticket.
But you don't live in Bloomington.
And go see it.
Oh, I don't live in here. But does it count? I commute here every day.
It's okay.
It's a $70 ticket.
That's too much. I'm out.
For a 3-day comedy festival. Are you kidding me?
It's not bad. I've done it a couple times. Really good.
$3 a day.
I come back every single year.
Two years ago, Patton Oswalt was the headliner.
You know how many eggs I can buy for $75?
Do you know the women amount of eggs I can buy? All right.
Yes.
Last question.
Anyway, Mark Maron.
Last question.
Is the guy I associate most with.
Really, Mark Maron.
Skip over that.
I like Mark Maron as a podcast host.
I get like his.
I don't like him as a comedian.
Wait a second. We're at the last question.
Yeah, for the conclusion.
Oh God.
And this is for you, Alex.
I thought we were going for like an hour plus.
I felt like I had so much to say about these comedian things.
All right, so fuck it.
I feel bad. I wish I would have done more comedy. I wish I would have stayed in comedy.
Mark Maron, he is your top.
He's my spirit animal. He is my spirit animal, not top. Like he's not the best, but when he does a stand-up, I'm like, oh my god, I fucking get it. Like
so,
that's
when you
me.
Call Mark Maron your spirit animal, is that because he's Jewish?
No, Ryan is not Jewish.
No, I'm not Jewish, but like,
no, I was asking if you call him an animal because he's Jewish.
Oh, is that a thing we're going with? We're gonna do
I don't know. I guess a better question is, Ryan, are you racist against the Jewish people?
I will answer for
really
Ryan and
don't
say yes.
I have much against anybody except for everybody. Like it's not as much as like I don't like a certain race. I don't like anybody. That is not me.
Ryan, would you say Jew lives matter?
It's a hard question. That's
okay, definitely not a hard question. We're not 1940s Germany, man. We're not in Poland.
Oh, this is the fucking 1930s. I fucking love this, man. All right, for real. My last question to you, and it's more of a broad. Alex, advice for someone who wants to start comedy, or because of your previous specifications, comedy / acting. The best advice you could give somebody involved in
just
that.
Fucking do it.
All
just
right.
do it.
Like, I knew that was it, but I had to ask.
Yeah, I mean, we may as well just cut to Shia LaBeouf yelling, just do it.
Just fucking do it!
Right?
All
right.
The biggest thing is to surround yourself by... If you do this, you are going to meet a lot of fucking assholes.
Yes.
You're going to meet a lot of people that think that they are better than they are and that they're at a higher level than they really are.
I think any creative field you get into that.
If you do that... When I started doing acting, I stayed away from people that just talked about themselves. If they wanted to talk about me, if they wanted to ask what I was doing, we'll figure this out together. But if they just were like, I'm going to do this, and I'm going to do this, and this is what I got coming up, I was like, no, got time. Move on to the next one. Because there's so many people in this industry that think that they've already made it. If you want to know that stand-up, it's going to be hard and long, and you're going to be by yourself. If it's acting, there are some great people that'll help you along the way. Those are the people that'll tell you that you have a unique look, that you should talk to an agent, that you should change your facial hair. How long have you known me with a mustache?
Not
mustache is relatively new.
Yeah.
The entire time I know you.
But that's the thing.
Like, literally.
Is people that want you to succeed are going to tell you good ideas and then let you run with them, whether you take them or not. You know? I want to know. Here's a question. When are you moving to Chicago?
Oh, well, shit.
It's not in the near future. But I might take a day trip to work with you on an acting or comedic thing.
If you want to, I can send out that. It gets a little light in the summer or in the wintertime. But I'll send you any information that you're interested in.
I will act in anything. I know that me and Ryan have a project in the works acting-wise via our sound engineer's overarching director. That's the T-Bear. He has some script he gave us.
That was a very convoluted way to just say fucking Tyler. Tyler has a script.
Tyler has a script that he wants us to work on. I really enjoy acting myself.
Acting's awesome. I know that you've done acting. You were a zombie in a movie.
I was a zombie in one movie, and I've done a couple other things.
I love acting. I think it's fun. And actually, in talking with both of you, it's actually given me, like, kind of an interest to kind of dabble back into stand-up.
I wish you would, man. Okay. I really did enjoy you in stand-up. I saw you a couple of times. We performed once together. I would like to perform with you again.
It's just
I've not seen your stand-up, but you made one out of one sound engineers lose his shit.
He's over fucking loved
gray cakes. Gray wedding cakes.
Baby cakes? Did anybody watch China, Illinois in here?
Yeah, I love Chocolate. Oh, God.
Is it? I don't know what this
it's
is.
It's a canceled show on Adult Swim. Man. It's fucking good.
Adult Swim.
Definitely stop acting so bored, Ryan.
The Eric Andre show is good. The rest of Adult Swim now is kind of garbage.
Nah.
It's garbage. It's mostly garbage. Venture Brothers is gone. All the good shit's gone. Eh.
Venture Brothers gone?
Everything's got to go through.
Oh, I guess they do like 3 or 4 years in between, so we don't know if they're gone or not.
Peaks and Valleys, yes. Dog. It'll come back.
Breach.
Alex, all right,
no more Frisky Dingo. No C-Lab 2020.
Alex, man, thank you so fucking much for coming.
Thank you. I was so excited when you asked me to be on the show.
I don't see a time when, if you ever want to come back, free reign. You just let us know when you are available.
Yeah.
I
completely 100% agree, because I guess I have to.
That's the great thing about being an unmentioned, unabashed show leader, I guess, that my co-host.
I'm glad that Ryan had such a good time with me coming down for this.
I have to
for me back. Driving an hour here to do that. I'm glad he had a good time with it.
Wait, how the fuck did you drive here from Chicago in an hour?
Oh, Martinsville.
Okay, Martinsville.
Yeah, you had to go through all, you know, you had to drive through all the Trump supporters and then get here.
Thank you so fucking much for coming down and for talking to us about stupid bullshit for however long we did, man.
We just talked about what I've been doing for the last year, and you said stupid fucking bullshit.
That's all I wanted to hear. Nice.
Thanks for talking about this stupid fucking bullshit, man. That is your life.
I got this from you via Facebook, but I was like, no, let's fucking come down and force an episode of the podcast about it.
I feel like we forced it. Yeah, I really feel like we forced the shit out of it.
For sure. And this might be the last
episode template.
Ever.
That's
It was great. I love it. I'm terrified to listen back to it. But this really is one of my favorite podcasts that I etch out time to listen to. Thank you so much.
We do not deserve that, but thank you.
Ryan is our harshest critic. I am our biggest fan. And I think that gives us a great dichotomy.
That's sad.
When your powers combine.
When our powers do combine.
We
form a big gray ball of myth. Because
no, for real, thank you, Alex, man. I wish you the absolute best of luck in the future. I love you, man. I'm glad I met you for that month that we worked together, and that for some weird, ridiculous reason, this friendship has continued. You're a pretty awesome dude. Ryan, I love you too.
Oh, you don't have to put that in there. Just keep talking about him. That's fine.
He's the best.
That's weird. This guy was feeling weird. I appreciate that he started to go to you, but thanks for picking that up for me, man.
So, Alex, would you please tell the audience to go fuck themselves?
Experience great audience. Please go fuck yourself.
That is the end. Thank you all so much. Grind out.
Hi, this is Ryan, and if you liked what you just saw or listened to, please check us out at experiencegrind.com. Find us on facebook.com/experiencegrind, at Twitter, over at twitter.com/expgrindpodcast, where Kyle's tweeting out a lot of stuff all the time. And then you can always find us, our podcast, on iTunes, Stitcher, Twitch, or even on YouTube. Find us, just search Experience Grind Podcast. We don't have a channel yet. Stuff super easy to find. But please subscribe. We'll get there to you, make it even easier. And as always, if you like what you saw, we cover mini games and episodes every week. There's sure to be something you love. And as always, grind out.